In 1879, the British army in southern Africa was at war with the Zulu nation.
Zubeka! Zubeka! Come and look at this, sir!
On January the 22nd, a scouting party was sent out to find the enemy.
We just managed to bring down a...
2 miles north of the British camp, they found them. Thousand Zulu warriors were advancing to meet a British army of only 1,500 men. They met here at Isandlwana. 100 years later, a team of filmmakers set about reconstructing the events that led to the battle. The whole project was to cost £7 million and involve more than 6,000 people. No living person remembers the Zulu Wars, and so a great deal of research had to be done. Every detail of uniforms and military badges had to be carefully checked, and the design team relied on museums, history books, old prints and drawings. The filmmakers needed to know why the war had been fought. 100 years ago, the British thought of the whole of southern Africa as their territory. Queen Victoria's army had arrived to enforce Britain's claim, and the Zulus, who had always been there, were expected to obey their new rulers. And to protect the colony, the British were prepared to go to war. More than 5,000 extras would be used in the main battle scenes, and they all had to be dressed and armed. Weapons of the period existed in museums, but not in the huge numbers the film would need. They all had to be made. With the Zulu weapons, there was another problem. Many of the skills involved in making them had long since been forgotten. This was also true of many traditional dances and customs. They all had to be relearned. The ornaments worn by Zulu warriors had to be accurate in every detail, and careful copies were made from museum exhibits. These ornaments were not just for decoration. They often showed how important a warrior was. They all meant something, and the designer spent many months putting together the right costumes. The property master had a different problem. Zulu warriors carried only spears, shields made from animal hide, and wooden clubs called knobkerries, but they would all be used in vast numbers. For the British army, attention to detail was just as important. The cavalry wore blue, but infantry uniforms were red. The badges, buttons, and insignia of the 24th Regiment all had to be remade, recast for the occasion. One of the biggest jobs to be done was the reconstruction of the Zulu camp, or kraal. The huts were built by Zulu men and women in the traditional way, the wooden staves being bent over to form the framework upon which dried grass is woven. This, the largest hut, is for the Zulu chief, King Cetshwayo. The cast of Zulus had to be trained for their role in the film too. They needed to be expert in the traditional dances, songs, and battle skills of their ancestors of 1879. So a team of Zulu historians lived with them and rehearsed them.
Move up!
Many months were spent training the men and horses which would make up the British cavalry of Victorian times. There were about 150 horses in all, and some had to be trained to pull gun carriages. Horses were also trained in battle conditions to get them used to the noise. And both they and the men were taught how to fall.
Two, go! Three, go! Four, go! Five, go! Six, go! Seven, go! Eight, go! Nine, go! Ten, go! Thank you, brother.
Even the most difficult falls, like this one, demonstrated here by the master of horse, are not harmful to either rider or animal if done properly. But they are the result of long, hard training. Before the first day's filming, 600 actors had to have their hair cut in the style of the period. Then, of course, there was makeup to be done, and particularly the makeup of what are known as doubles. This is where one actor, usually a stuntman, is made to look like another and takes his part in dangerous scenes. Horses, too, need to be doubled, a fact often overlooked, since not every horse is trained to perform the necessary stunts. This is a stunt double being made up to look like Peter O'Toole, as we see him in his role as Lord Chelmsford, the commanding officer of the British forces. In the British camp at Pietermaritzburg, the army assembles, and the native cavalry is put through its paces. The British army used native troops if they could. This particular group were called the Sikali horse. These men were not part of the Zulu nation and didn't mind fighting them. However, the British had taught them to ride, and so the filmmakers also had to get local people to this standard of horsemanship. Native troops had British commanding officers, one of whom was Lieutenant Vereker, played here by Simon Ward. Vereker had to prove his ability to command the Sikali horse by firing from the shoulder at a stationary object while riding at the gallop. The side of beef was wired with a small explosive charge, which was detonated as Vereker fired. In 1879, the Zulu king had refused to submit to British rule, and the army planned to march into Zululand and teach him a lesson. From the British base in Pietermaritzburg, there's a 14-day march to Zululand, but the filmmakers wanted to restage just one spectacular sequence, the crossing of the Buffalo River, which marked the border of Kechweyo's kingdom. In the finished film, the colors cross the river first, followed by a group of lancers. Victorian methods, pontoons, rafts to carry the infantry had to be built. While working at the site of the crossing, Rorke's Drift, the film crew discovered some of the remains of the pontoons used in 1879. so they could be sure they were filming in exactly the spot where the British entered Zululand 100 years earlier. The battle sequences of the film presented their own peculiar problems. Many special effects are used to make fighting look realistic. Spears are drilled to take a wire so that they can be thrown accurately. The wire will not show up on the film. Shields are fitted with what is called a bullet hit effect, in a similar way to the side of beef we saw earlier. The shield is strengthened to protect the man carrying it. Hand-to-hand fighting, like this, must be rehearsed many times. The British used rockets for the first time at the Battle of Isandlwana. They proved ineffective as a weapon, but nevertheless they terrified the Zulus, and probably the British soldiers who used them. Sometimes filming is more dangerous for the crew than for the actors. Added to all this was the problem of keeping so many people fed. The average weekly food bill was £15,000. Even relaxation was taken in uniform. For the battle itself, the British soldiers are marched to their positions and form ranks. British infantry fought in two ranks, a technique going back to the days of muskets. It meant that the regiment could keep a steady rate of fire even when men were reloading. The assistant directors helped prepare the Zulu warriors, rehearsing the battle cry, "Uzutu! Uzutu! Kill!" This is the final battle sequence, at the climax of the film. In 1879, the British generals had not expected to meet a large, well-organized Zulu army. In spite of their superior weapons, the British could not hope to survive a battle in which they were outnumbered 15 to 1. The proud force that had left Pietermaritzburg was caught in a savage and bloody fight for survival. And the feature film tried to capture their desperation.
Save the colours. Get towards drift. You must warn them. The colours. Carry them to safety, Mr. Melville. Sir.
The result was a massacre. In the final hour, almost 1,500 British troops were slaughtered. Filmmakers, of course, are better off. Their dead men can walk away. Thank you.